I thought he did a good job last week. Stepped in with only about 12 hours of prep, and I thought he did a great job. Anyway, I'm going to read from Luke chapter 18 today, the first eight verses. This chapter is one of those chapters that I wish wasn't there. And I'll explain that a little bit more in a little bit. I believe that the beginning of this chapter should actually be included in the passage that comes before it. So as I read this, keep in mind that I'm coming in the middle of what Jesus is teaching here. Verse 1 says, "And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought always to pray and not lose heart. He said, in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man. And there was a widow in that city who kept coming to him and saying, 'Give me justice against my adversary.' For a while he refused, but afterward he said to himself, 'Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice so that she will not beat me down by her continual coming.' And the Lord said, 'Hear what the unjust judge says. And will not God give justice to his elect who cry to him day and night? Will he delay long over them? I tell you, he will give justice to them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith in the earth?'" This is the word of God. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful for your word and the teaching that it gives us. I'm thankful for the preservation of it and the proliferation of it and our ability to read it and understand it. But Father, there's a big difference between understanding it and applying it. And as we learn your word, we ask you to change us through the Spirit's work in our life and the clarity of your word. And give us the drive to give you the glory you deserve. As we seek to glorify you with all of our life, we also offer our tithes and offerings and ask you to use them, not just for our benefit, but for the benefit of our loved ones and our community. I ask you to give wisdom to those who manage these funds and our resources, that as we move forward into a new year, we will see lives change in ways that we can't even begin to imagine. We offer you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
185, while we're taking the offering, we'll sing a song. You're all alone, huh? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. He will stay close beside me all the way. He's prepared a home for me, and someday his face I'll see. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. And turn to 705. This is our special. Cynthia is having a rough time, having to cough all the time, and she didn't want to get here and cough halfway through. So we're going to sing, 705? Yep. Good song, "It Is Well With My Soul." And we need to keep praying for Cynthia, having tough time, and Trusty's getting better, and they can find out other things that's wrong with her and get her back going. So keep praying for Cynthia. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate, and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. Verse 4. And Lord, haste a day when the face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Good job. Well, at this point, we would normally just... Well, while they're, hey, something happened. I don't know. It doesn't matter. But I do want to thank you all for being here this morning. I have preached at an empty sanctuary one time. I thought it was a rousing success, but I also preached at one time. Say it again.
No tomatoes.
There might be some this morning, but... also, I preached one time in a blizzard. I was on the Wyoming border in Colorado, and I had one person showed up for that blizzard, and he had started the day heading to church in Colorado Springs and drove through the blizzard to get there. So I'm aware that there are some people that are diehard worshipers. And I'm assuming that that's kind of the group that I'm speaking to this morning, and I'm glad you're here this morning. But I also want to, for the benefit of the recording and everything, I want to congratulate those who had the wisdom to look at their own physical condition and their own safety and say, God does not require human sacrifices anymore, and were wise enough to stay home if that was the wise thing to do. And so I want to say congratulations to both groups. Before we look into God's word here, let's take just a moment here and ask for his blessing. Father, as we're here in this building this morning, I want to thank you for the furnaces and the nice warm environment that we have here. I want to thank you for those that have braved the ice and the slick roads to come and give you the glory you deserve. I want to ask you to bless those who will be seeing this video later and being blessed by your word. And ask you, no matter what choice we had to make to receive the glory for it, Lord, we're thankful for the freedom we have to worship you, but we don't want to be irresponsible either, and so we're thankful for your Spirit's guidance. So at this point, we ask you, just whoever or however we're hearing this message, that you would speak to us in ways that we might not have expected, and help us to grow and be more faithful to you. And I ask for it in Jesus' name. Amen. I have to tell you, I got really excited this week because I found that picture. Now, I know many of you who are sitting further back can't see the details of that picture, and that's not a big deal. I'll explain it to you here in a little bit. But I've been looking for that picture for 20 years. This is the altar that I grew up worshiping at. And I found that on the internet. Now, I grew up worshiping in a little tiny Lutheran church in Durham, Kansas, which is about 9 miles north of Hillsboro. Most of you know where Hillsboro is. And that building's not there anymore. And when my dad had to close the building, he sold that altar to a church in Wichita. And then we found out during that process that it was actually going back to the church that commissioned its construction. And they'd put it in their small sanctuary, their small chapel. And I'd always wanted to go back and get pictures of it. I was upset with my dad that he didn't let me just take it. This huge piece of furniture, and it was always at the very back of the platform in our church. Now, the reason this is so significant to me, to help you understand that, you're going to have to understand the way the church was laid out. It was one of those little, tiny country chapels where it only hold about 75 people. And when they bought the pews, they didn't measure the sanctuary first, and they ended up with pews that were too big for the building. And so on the north side of the chapel, there was just a really tiny little aisle, and then there were two pews that would each hold about 5 people, and then there was an aisle, and then another row of pews that would hold about 5 people. So you'd have about 10 people there and about 5 people there. Well, that meant when you come in the center door in the back, you had to shift to the south about half a pew, and you walked up, and if you walked all the way to the front, you came to the corner of the platform about right here. Well, I was an altar boy. In fact, I was the only boy in the church. There were people who were old enough to be my parents' grandparents, and then there were my parents, and then there was me, and that was the way the ages were distributed. So I was the altar boy, and back here, the back corner of the platform was the door that the pastor and I would come in through. I would wait for him in back there because he had another church that he preached at next town over, and he would always come in at the last minute. Then I would come out, and I would light the 2 candles on the altar, and I would come down off the platform and lay the candlestick in the pew, and then I would sit right here, dead on the corner, because I'm obsessive compulsive that way. And I would sit there with my shoulder blades right up against the back of the pew, and I would try to listen to him preach. But the pulpit wasn't in the middle, it was way over here. And so I was sitting way over there, and I would sit with my shoulder blades against the back of the pew, and I would try to twist my head to see, and my neck got sore after a while. So rather than look at him, I would look at this pulpit. And I can tell, I memorized that pulpit, the Alpha and the Omega on the sides, the Trinity of spires on each side, the 4-pointed cross at the bottom. It's perfect, even the picture in the middle. And after I got studied that for 2 or 3 years, I began to focus more on the portrait in the middle, which I found out later was a detail from a portrait called Agony at Gethsemane. And as I looked at that, I began to study the glory of Christ's praying for the cup to be removed. But after a couple of months, even that wasn't enough to keep a 14-year-old's attention. And then I noticed these three guys in the background. You know what they're doing? They're sleeping. While Jesus is going through the agony of preparation for the cross, these three guys, who just a matter of days before had been taught how to pray by Jesus himself, are taking a nap. So I thought, as I was remembering this, this would be a good time, being the first Sunday in a brand new year, 2022, to look at the way Jesus prayed and the teaching that he gave us in prayer. And we're going to take a good long look over this week and the next two of what Luke recorded about Jesus' prayer life. And that's where we come to Luke chapter 18. Today I'm calling the message, Learning from the Master. And I'm going to focus on the question, how do we prepare for the kingdom to come? To get the context, we have to remember that he's talking about something bigger than just prayer here. I mentioned it before when I read the text, that this passage actually starts, the beginning of this chapter is actually in the beginning of his teaching. He's been teaching about coming, his next coming. And we as Americans today, we do have a little bit of a tendency to be impatient for that, don't we? Oh, let's be honest, we're Americans, we're impatient about everything. We want everything right now. I mean, we're the people who invented the microwave. We want what we want, and we want it before we want it. And we have this tendency to get a little bit anxious for things to happen. We also have a tendency to get a little bit irritated when they don't happen quick enough. It's what I call eagerness, that I want it to happen quickly, and it's not happening fast enough. And in the church, when we start talking about Jesus returning, we have that eagerness, don't we? We start out really on fire. We're burning. Jesus is returning. We got to get the world ready. We got to let people know Jesus is coming. We got to get our theology straight. We've got to do it all well and be ready for the king to return. And then our enthusiasm burns out. And we begin to wonder, when? And then we begin to see the other things that are happening around us, and we get distracted. And very quickly, we lose interest. We move on to the next hot button. And that's exactly the process that Jesus was worried was going to happen when he gave us this teaching this morning. We have to get the context by going back into chapter 17 to about verse 20, where the Pharisees ask Jesus, when is the kingdom going to come? That apparently was a fairly common question at the time. When is God going to establish the kingdom of Israel over the whole world, and we're going to get to give the rest of the world their comeuppance? And we're going to rule over them, and they're going to serve us. And Jesus gave the only answer he ever gave to that question. There's several places in the Bible where it's recorded, but he only gave one answer. And the answer is always, I'm not telling. Which I imagine probably raised some ire at the time. But he did give just some brief instruction. He did say that until that time, there would be many false claimants for the king. And we've seen that throughout history, many people claiming to be messiahs. I did a research one time on false messiahs, and I got pages and pages and pages of names of people who thought that they were the Messiah, all the way up to the middle of the 1800s. So there would be many people who would come and say, you know, it's out there or it's over there. And he basically says, just ignore them. He says, there won't really be any signs. He says, it's going to be just like the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, or just like the days of Noah. Until God intervened, nobody saw it coming. But when God did intervene, He said there would be no turning back. Don't go back to your house. Don't go out to your field because it's too late. And then we see that great big number 18. And I mentioned this before, but maybe I'm the only one, but when I first started reading the Bible, I would see that great big number 18, and I'd remember what they told me in public school. You know, when you got a new chapter, you got a new topic. But you know, Luke didn't write a great big number 18 there. All the chapters and verses were added later for convenience so that we could find the same page and read together. That's not inspired. Especially when you consider that conjunction, the very first word that Luke writes in chapter 18 is and. It's the Greek word day, spelled delta epsilon. And if you're looking at it and you're an English speaker, it looks like the italics for a D and an E. Day. But it's a specific conjunction in Greek that adds to what was said before. It's connecting what was said before to what's about to be said. And Luke says, and he gave them this parable to teach them that they should continue to pray and not lose heart. And as Luke presents the parable, we have to remember that he's connecting this to the teaching that you're not going to know when he's going to come. You're not going to know the hour or the date or the month or the year. It's going to be a surprise. And he's saying, and with that in mind, we have to continue to pray. And he uses this illustration of a judge, an unjust judge, he says, a person in a village who has the right to rule in court cases, and he doesn't fear God or fear man. He's in the judgeship simply for what he can get. I imagine he's got heavy court costs for every case that he hears. And there's a widow in that town. And in their culture, a widow had no legal representation at all. She could not stand before the court herself and give her case. And if she didn't have a male family member to stand with her, the judge wasn't obligated to hear anything that she had to say. Someone was cheating her, and she asked for justice. And at first, the judge just ignores her. But after a while, he decides, you know, she's going to keep coming. She's a typical Yiddish grandma. She's not going to give up on this. She's going to keep pestering me. I might as well just give her what she wants so she'll leave me alone. What Jesus is pointing out here is that human judges sometimes judge unjustly. And that's a point that he's trying to make here. Don't look at the coming of Christ from a human standpoint. Look at it from God's point of view. Look at it from what he's trying to accomplish instead of your limited viewpoint. Because the judge of the universe, as Abraham said, will do what's right. And so Jesus looks at his students and he says, now listen to what the unjust judge says. And will not the God of the universe do what is right? He goes on to say, that his elect he will give justice to, and not just give them justice, but give it speedily, quickly. From God's point of view. Because God knows all the details. From God's point of view, he will do what is right. God isn't like human judges. He knows things we don't know. He has a perspective that we don't have, that we can't have. He knows what other people need to go through before it's right for him to grant our requests. He knows what's really in the heart of other human beings. And he knows how to answer our requests in the best possible timing to meet the request that we would have asked if we'd have known what he knew. But at the end of the teaching, he finishes with the unfortunate outcome that he expects. He says, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on earth? Will the elect still be praying. Will the elect still trust God to do what is right, even if what God has to do isn't comfortable? Will those who believe in Jesus Christ really trust Him for the long haul? People will lose faith. What Jesus is trying to say to us this morning is that prayer is the right response to delays. Now, in the context, he's saying that prayer is the right response when his return delays. But we live in a world where there's a lot of delays, don't we? We live in a world where we've been praying now for, is this the third calendar year or the second calendar year, depending on how you count it, for COVID to go away. Many of us have been praying for years for loved ones to come to faith in Jesus Christ. Several of us have been praying for health issues for months or years that haven't been answered yet. We live in a world where it's easy to think God might be dragging his feet. But is that faith? I think we need to be careful in our prayer life. We need to be cautious that we don't let things like boredom stop us from praying. I know what it's like. I pray every morning. Every request on that bulletin, I lift to the Lord every morning. I know what it's like to feel like I said this yesterday and the day before. And the day before, and the day before. It's boring. I sit there sometimes and just try to think of new and creative ways to say it. But God isn't interested in us being entertaining. He's interested in us being faithful. We have to be very careful that distractions don't stop us from praying. I could easily I've probably got one of the most distractible minds in the world. I sit before three monitor screens when I'm praying. It's easy for me to say, wait a minute, I got to look that up. Or maybe I can find a better word and get my thesaurus out. It's easy for me to understand how people say, well, you know, Good Morning America's on, and I might find something new to pray about. You know, there's all kinds of things. That telephone rings. And I answer it. And then I say, well, should I go back to praying? Should I let that distraction stop me? We need to be very careful, though. We're not being distracted in that way. The final thing that I want to warn you about this morning is frustration. Because it's difficult to continue to pray, especially if you get that hint that other people have stopped. If you get that inkling, somehow Satan puts it in your mind or somebody says something that makes you think, well, maybe other people have stopped praying. Maybe I should give up. That's not what Jesus is teaching us this morning. Jesus gave this parable so that we might not give up praying and not lose heart. And so this being the first Sunday in the year 2022, I would encourage you, pray. Pray. That's never fair for a pastor to stand up and say something like pray and not give you some guidance on how. And so I'm going to give you some thoughts. Take notes, apply what you think works for you, what will help you, but especially when it comes to scheduling, I would encourage you to pray every day. Every day. I might be preaching to the choir here a little bit this morning, but I know that it's difficult for some people to get up in the morning and have some time for God. But I'm not going to give up on that. Because I think that's a significant thing. If you don't get up in the morning and set aside some time to be with God, when are you going to set aside some time to be with God? And I know it's difficult to get up an hour early. We live in a world where if you don't stay up and watch the late show, you somehow feel like you've been left out. But find some time during the day, every day, to pray. I think that a good devotional time would involve some devotional aid like Our Daily Bread or something else that you like. I usually listen to it on my phone. They've got an app where they read it to me. And then reading a certain segment of God's Word every day. I believe everybody in this room, I'm looking around here, I think everybody in this room, I think anybody who'd be hearing this on the internet would probably be intelligent enough to read the whole Bible in a year. Only takes about 5 chapters a day. If you want to take a little bit longer, then just read 1 chapter a day. But then set aside a half an hour or 45 minutes to talk to God every day. If you feel like a half hour or 45 minutes might be a little too ambitious, come back next week. I'm going to tell you how to fill that time. And I can promise you, a half hour or 45 minutes isn't long enough. Because Jesus taught us how to have devotional prayers. Every day builds a relationship. But I also would encourage you to pray together at least once a week. We should pray privately every day, but we should pray corporately regularly. And in this congregation, we have the perfect opportunity to do that. We meet every single Wednesday at 6 o'clock. I realize that there are some challenges to that if you've got people in school, got kids in school, or you've got a job that keeps you a little bit later. But really, is prayer important? Really? Do we want to pass on to the next generation the significance of prayer? That's going to take some effort. Why don't we take that effort on Wednesday evening? There may be some, I agree, that have a challenge. I mean, if you get to a certain age, you don't want to drive after dark because your eyesight is a challenge. There may be some weeks when something happens when you can't be there, but as a general rule, most of us, if we just took the time to manage our time, could make it. There are exceptions. People in healthcare sometimes can't get off on Wednesday, and they're doing a good work. Or police officers or firemen can't make it on a Wednesday evening. But as a congregation, do we offer an alternative? If we really believe that prayer is important, we should ask ourselves if we should offer an alternative. Should we have a Wednesday luncheon for prayer? Should we have a Thursday in the middle of the afternoon where people can gather for prayer? Should we meet together on Tuesdays for coffee in the middle of the morning for prayer? Should we meet at the coffee shop downtown, or should we meet in the fellowship hall here at the church? Are we doing all that we can do to make corporate prayer available? And are we encouraging all the people enough that corporate prayer has value? We need to be thinking about those kinds of things. Because Jesus told a parable that we would not lose heart and not give up on prayer. We need to be helping each other fight the temptation to lose heart and to keep that steam going, even when it takes a long time for a reply. And remember, answered prayer is only one of the benefits of an active prayer life. And getting our prayers answered is really, I don't want to say secondary, but it's not the only benefit. I mean, when we're praying, we're improving our relationship with God. Every relationship expert will tell you the key to a good relationship is communication. And prayer is communication with God. It's talking to Him and letting His Spirit talk back to us. It builds that relationship. It also improves our thankfulness. As Americans, we have that tendency, I think just as human beings, we have that tendency to gimme, 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 gimme. You know, I'll put in my 5 cents worth of prayer in the slot machine and God ought to give me what I ask for. But as we pray, especially together, it adds to our thankfulness because people will begin to praise God for what He's already answered. And sometimes when you get the real mature prayers, they'll praise God for the things He hasn't answered yet. Another benefit is it improves our witness. One of the challenges that believers have as they witness to their friends the goodness of God is they can't think of anything to say that God has done good. But as we meet together in prayer, as we share each other's prayer requests and the support that we give each other through those requests, it becomes a testimony to how Jesus is working through the church. And when we meet that person at the beauty shop or the mechanic shop who life just isn't going well, we can say, we had a friend like that, and our church walked through it with them. You ought to come and see what Jesus did for us. And if He doesn't do anything for you, at least we'll walk through it with you. It'll increase your witness quite a bit. And finally, it will increase your peace. One of the great things that I liked about the liturgy in the Lutheran church was they always finished with, be anxious for nothing, but in all things, by prayer and petition, make your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God will keep your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Some of the more modern translations, if you didn't know, that's Philippians chapter 4. Some of the modern translations translate the word keep with guard. Will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. So while we're waiting, whether we're waiting for a cure for COVID or we're waiting for our loved one to become a believer in Jesus Christ, or we're waiting for that new job or that healthcare crisis to go away, pray. Don't lose heart. Prayer makes the waiting worth it. Let's close this message in prayer. Father, we thank You for the encouragement of Your word. And I thank You for the promise that persistent prayer has value. I want to thank You that You have not limited Yourself to answer our prayers the way we want them answered, but You maintain Your sovereignty and Your right to answer the prayers in a better way. I confess for myself, Lord, and I'm sure there's others in this room who have lost hope and prayer from time to time, have wondered whether You're listening, have questioned Your timing, or criticized Your speed. We thank You for Your forgiveness. We take this passage as a reminder that Your timing is perfect, and we can commit at this point to continue in our walk with You in close fellowship through prayer and lifting up our requests, but giving You also praise and thanks for who you are and what you do. And as we march through 2022, we trust you, the judge of the universe, to do what's right. I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.